use of lectures on Nathan's
Okay, so I would like to start the lecture with an apology. That would not be a roll time. I said very well known because this lecture period coincided with my teaching at Pisa University, so I cannot be here all time for discussion. Okay, when I'm here, I'm happy to talk with students for whatever is needed. And okay, and I thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity to talk about entanglement in this lecture. And then we'll start from something very basic. That's just what is the entanglement? As you all know from quantum mechanical courses, we usually say that if we have let's consider two spins, one out, and we consider them in space plus minus plus, if we normalize the divide by the first of two. As we know from undergraduate studies, this state is entangled in the sense that if one observer measures the spin one entangled values plus, then the other observer will always find values minus, independently on how far it is, and etc. Oppositely, if we have just a state that is plus minus, for example, this state is not entangled. But as physicists, we would like to say something more than yes or no, and we would like to quantify how much entanglement is in this state, how much entanglement is in these other states, and also we would like a criterion that is not based just on looking a state if it's entangled or not. I could write you, for example, this state divided by two, and naively, just by looking, someone could say, but this state looks entangled. Instead, if you look more carefully at the state, you can just realize that this is nothing but the state that is just a tensor product of two states in the basis of sigma. It's just two spin aligned in the x direction. Okay? So it's not entangled at all. It's just a product state. And, okay, the goal would be, even when having more spins, more difficult degrees of freedom, to understand without trying to decompose the state in some product of something, if a state is or not. And in this respect, when we have two spins, it's quite easy to understand what we are, how to deal with this. And the idea is just to construct from a given state psi the density matrix rho equal the bracket psi psi in the Dirac notation. That's, for example, for two spin, it's just a 4x4 matrix. Okay. And this matrix, let's just try to construct how this matrix is done for a generic state to understand what we are talking about. And like we take the state psi given by an arbitrary combination alpha plus 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 beta plus minus plus gamma minus plus plus delta minus minus. Okay, so this is an arbitrary state made by 2x2 spin. The density matrix corresponding to this state is just if we put plus plus here, plus minus here, minus plus, minus minus, and the same on the column. The density matrix corresponding to this state, admitting that everything is normalized to 1, these alpha such that they are normalized to 1, it's just alpha squared, alpha beta, alpha gamma, alpha delta, alpha beta, beta squared,
beta gamma, beta delta, alfa gamma, beta gamma, gamma square, gamma delta, and alfa delta, beta delta, beta gamma, delta square. This is the density matrix corresponding to state of use. Now, from this density matrix, we want to extract an object that will be very important for the entanglement, that is the reduced density matrix of one spin. That is defined as the sum of the indices of the second spin. Okay, so in general, rho will have two indices, I and j, but we can imagine this is tensor flow, so we have rho I1, I2, j1, j2. Where one corresponds to the first spin and two correspond to the second spin, and we can introduce the reduced density matrix rho one that will depend only on the spin one, so we have only two indices I one and J one that goes from one to two. Okay, which is equal to the trace over the second spin of the full row, the full density matrix. That means identify the indices corresponding to the second spin and summing over them. Okay? So, in principle, we have as indices row A1, J1, I2, I2. So, I'm summing over the second indices. And if one constructs explicitly this 2 by 2 matrix, what one gets, you can do as an exercise of making the sum with just alpha squared plus beta squared, alpha, alpha gamma plus beta delta, alpha gamma plus beta delta again of the same matrix, gamma squared plus delta squared. Now, the interesting thing is that while the matrix from which we start corresponds to a pure state, okay, and so is a rank 1 matrix, it means that there's one eigenvalue that is 1 that corresponds to these eigenvalues, and all the other eigenvalues are 0. So, if you wish, trace of rho to the n is equal to 1, because there's only one non-zero eigenvalue, which is 1. This matrix generically is not a rank 0 matrix. A rank 1 matrix, in fact, is the determinant. It's just the determinant of rho 1 is equal to alpha squared plus beta squared, gamma squared plus delta squared, minus alpha gamma plus beta delta, everything squared. If you expand this object, you can write in the form alpha delta minus beta gamma squared, which is equal to zero if and only if alpha delta minus beta gamma is equal to zero. Else, the matrix usually will have two different eigenvalues, both non-zero, if that condition is not satisfied. And so the system, the reduced density matrix of one spin is not the one of a pure state, and the state is not entangled. Okay, so given this state from which we started, this state is entangled if this condition is not satisfied. And clearly the
how much the eigenvalues of this matrix differ from 1 and 0 gives an idea of how much entangled is in the state. Because we would, as I said from the beginning, we would like to give a number that is not just yes or no, 0 or 1, but is, it distinguishes the various cases.
Is this condition sufficient also? Or
for a 2x2 matrix, obviously, yes.
Yeah,
determinant
in the
general case, writing the general matrix would be horrible and we would construct something that
makes this, this equal to 0 condition is.
Of the determinant of the semi matrix is completely useless in the general case. But we are going there.
Okay.
What really matters is how much the eigenvalues deviate from 1. So, since we ended up in a mixed state, it's natural, if you want to give a single number, to use the von Neumann entropy of the mixed state, that means S1 is a minus trace of rho 1 log rho 1. This is just the von Neumann entropy that corresponds to this space as a measure of the deviation from 1 of these eigenvalues. If it is, you see, all the eigenvalues, this is nothing but minus number I of lambda I log lambda I, and this object is such that if lambda I is 1, gives exactly 0. So it's a natural complex measurement of the deviation from lambda to 1. Okay? And we will, this object has also another very important properties that if I construct instead of rho 1 the density matrix producer's matrix of first spin, I construct rho 2 the density, reduced density matrix. And of spin 2, that means instead of summing over second integer slash sum over the first one, rho I 1, rho I 1, and then j q I 2. In this very specific case of 2x2 matrix, the matrix that we obtain is just the same, just like symmetry. And in particular, so you will get that S1 is equal to S2. That means the entropy of the first spin is equal to the entropy of the second spin when one faces one or the other. And this is an important property. This is a very important property for something that we would like to call entanglement, because entanglement is not something of spin 1 or something of spin 2. It's something between the spin 1 and spin 2. You need two objects and you calculate the entanglement between the two. So it should not depend on the way you construct this quantity. Okay? And until now we have been very easy to consider one spin, two spins, but let's imagine a most generic case when we have a bunch of these spins.
Sorry, but what does it mean? This
entropy? It's a measure. One can prove in fundamental science, but this is out of what I want to discuss here, that this object is a proper measurement of entanglement in the sense that satisfies some properties that are called, in practice, that does not diminish under local operation and classical communication between the two channels, that means 1 and 2, but this sounds even more strange as request. From my point of view, this is quite intuitive, not because of some strange quantum information request, but it's mainly because to understand the entanglement, as I said, we want to understand how much this object is different from a pure state. A pure state is the one that has one eigenvalues, one, and all the other zero. And this is a completely natural measurement of measuring the distance from one eigenvalues, one. Okay, since the sum of the eigenvalues obviously should be also one, if one eigenvalue is not one, all the other should be non-one, and sum should be non-zero by definition. Okay, so obviously you can think, as we will do, even trace of row one to the n is a measure of how much the eigenvalues are different from one. In particular, if I take even the log of this object, this is one, this is object is zero when there is one eigenvalue that is one, and is non-zero when there are more eigenvalues that are non-zero. But in fact, this is an exactly good measure of entanglement as much as this. Okay? So, just for future reference, remember that this object also, that usually dividing by one or n minus one is called Rényi entropy. So, it reduces the constructing a spin one over the rain. This has as good measurement of entanglement as the entanglement entropy. So, from quantum information perspective, it's not different. This is an entanglement moton as good as this. But for this, I'm completely happy. So, if we just open a book of quantum information, this object is exactly like this, exactly because
if n equals to 1. This is 1 over 1 minus n?
Yes, the adiabatic limit. We use this abundantly in the future limit of for n that goes to 1, that 1n is just equal to the entanglement entropy s1. It's constructed on purpose in such a way that it's happens. Okay? You are anticipating what I will tell in a
few minutes. So it's entropy in the sense of loss of information.
Also,
it's not entropy in the thermodynamic sense.
It's not an entropy in the thermodynamic sense, obviously. In fact, we will show that it follows an area law, not a volume law, that would be a requirement for thermodynamics. So, we have these two objects that are, those two actually, they are infinite objects that have very good measurement of entanglement. But this one is the only one among these that satisfy another physical property that is not required by quantum information, but is required sometimes by physicists, that is a sort of subvariety. Okay, this is difficult to prove. I will not enter. This has been very important for, like, also for string theorists, etc. This quantity is the only one among these, all those, that satisfies a version of subadditivity that is called strong subadditivity. Okay, that's a property that for something we would like to be valid. Okay, so this is the only property, and it's not quantum information, that could. This special value n equal to 1 to another food compared to the other.
Yeah, but if I do a measurement in quantum mechanics, what is the lack of information that this S1 is telling me?
The lack of information that there are these usually two characters, Alice and Bob. Okay? One is the spin 1, one is the spin 2. In some state, but this state actually is entangled. Like something like this. The lack of information is exactly the lack of information that Alice has by sharing a state with Bob and does not know what Bob has. Okay? A priori, I have a given probability to make a certain measurement, but if Bob makes the measurement first before of Alice, this probability is 1. This is the information that is lost in this process. Okay. Thank you for the question, and let me go on. I want to discuss the more complicated case when we have many schemes and to start building up for quantum theory. So, in general,
let's imagine we have M spins.
And being arbitrary. And I can construct again the full density matrix as the bracket of the state sign which fits the keys. And this object usually will have now a huge number of indices, A1, A2, up to IN, and J1, J2, up to JN. Now, clearly, there is not a single way to divide the system. Okay. We will say that the first M spin, so from 1 to M, belongs to Alice, while from M plus 1 to N belongs to Bob. And in this way, we can construct the reduced density matrix of Alice. Let's draw A that will depend only on the index up to M, so I1, IM, J1, JM, as the place on the over the degrees of freedom that belongs to both of the full density matrix, that in indices is just row I1, IM, IM plus 1, IN, J1, JM, IN plus 1, IN. So I identify the indices of the part B of the system, that is the one that Bob has, and I leave as they were before the indices corresponding to Alice. And this is the reduced density matrix of the degrees of freedom that Alice can access. And from this reduced density matrix, I can construct again the entanglement entropy of trace of rho A, log rho A. Okay? Now, one can wonder, there are some properties that this object should satisfy, in particular this one, that the entanglement entropy of A should be equal to the entanglement entropy of B. Which property guarantees me this? In this case, the two matrices must not be equal at all, because I can choose N to be 3 and N to be 85, and the two marks will have very different dimension. Okay? Why their spectrum should be related at all, and the relation between the two spectrums, so it's given by the Schmidt decomposition, I always to check out the Schmidt. Schmidt decomposition is a theorem of linear algebra that tells that I can write any state of psi as a sum over some number alpha, some coefficient lambda alpha, W A alpha, tensor product W alpha B, where this object represents a normalized vector in the part A of the system, and this object represents a normalized vector in the part B of the system. Okay? And this property is not intuitive at all, but that is a theorem of linear algebra, because what is obvious, and that you all learn, is that I can write psi as sum over ij, some cij, psi I A tensor product J. That means given a basis, I can always decompose part in A, part in B, I can always decompose any arbitrary vector into a basis, into this basis that's a basis of full spaces. As you see, there is a fundamental difference between this sum that is obvious from this sum that is not obvious, that here is a sum over a single index.
So, what's on the left side? Psi?
Psi is an arbitrary state.
Yeah, but second, so psi, what's
the it's difference? Sum.
Yes. No, but in the second, what's the difference?
Here there is sum over two indices, one that run on the basis in A and one that run on the basis in B.
But how, okay, but on the left side, psi, what's it, psi?
This is at the same state.
The same state.
This is psi equal psi, I'm writing, okay?
But we will distinguish between them when they have different states.
No, 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 okay, no, this object is different, okay? Let me call B and B. Okay, what I'm saying, given an arbitrary state and given a basis that belongs part to the first n spin and part to the other n spin, that means I have all this matrix that is 10 by 10, I give 3 to 1 and 7 to 1, okay? I have a basis like this normal basis, A, I equal 0, 1 at position. Okay, one at position I, this is a basis. I can say the first half is A, the second half is B. Obviously, I can write any vector as sum of tensor product of vectors that belongs or to A or to B. This is the trivial part of the game. Okay, what I'm telling is that there is a theorem in linear algebra that is not as well known as this one that tells me that any state can be decomposed into a single sum over only one index. I don't have to sum over two indices, only one, okay? Where this W belongs to A, to the first part of the system, and this other W, B, belongs to B part of the system, both. And clearly this is possible because this basis that appears here is not fixed a priori, okay? It will depend on the state itself. While here I decide a basis and I do my decomposition, I can always do this, okay, by definition of basis. This decomposition exists because the basis I'm selecting will depend on the state. If I change state psi, I use different vector W, while here for an arbitrary state, I can always use the same basis.
The range of alpha is not fixed.
The range of alpha usually goes from 1 to the dimension to the minimum of the dimension between the hyperspace of A and the hyperspace of B. I wrote this formula because this formula shows, as in the case of two spins, that if only one lambda alpha is different from one, let's say lambda one is equal to one, then psi is a problem state
different from zero.
Sorry. Then psi is a product state and there is no entanglement. While if there are more of these objects different from zero, then the state will be entangled. And for example, just to give maximum entanglement, I will get maximum entanglement. Is for lambda alpha all equal and equal to what? To the dimension of to how many alpha I can go. So 1 divided this minimum between the dimension of h comma h b. And in fact, if we just take the definition of the entanglement entropy and we use on this basis, because this definition of entanglement entropy is independent of the basis, I can always trace over the A part of the system. What I will obtain is that what we have defined as entanglement entropy is not but minus sum over alpha of lambda alpha modulus squared log lambda alpha modulus squared. That in fact gives 0 if there is only one eigenvalue that is 1 and give its maximum value when the all is lambda alpha. Do you have questions on these first things?
Excuse me, for the maximum entanglement on this expression for lambda alpha, you should have a square root there, right?
Yeah. Right.
May you give some comments? What is mean for Alice Bob reference frame in the framework of at least at the non-relativistic level?
Reference
is
frame?
Alice, a mathematical symbol, is a classical system, is a quantum system.
It's
that axis between the reference frame how it is collected. Alice and Bob will make the measurements. All these things usually are in the background and are not clear.
Talking about frame is quite confusing. Maybe I would not like to use that word, but independent from that, I understand perfectly what you mean. I'm just trying to quantify if I have these two guys, Alice and Bob, around that share portion of a quantum system, what Alice and Bob have in common? What is the correlation of the quantum state between the two? Okay, so there is no classical information around. In fact, it's psi. I always consider as a pure state. That is nothing, the state from which we start is pure. Okay, we will generally have to mix state much after in this course, not now. Okay, and this is just the amount of information that the two persons share. If the entanglement is zero, there is no information between the two. Okay. If the entanglement is zero, the state between the two is not entangled. Whatever Alice makes, Bob will not be effective. There is no sharing of information between the two parts. Okay? If the entanglement is non-zero, okay, so the entanglement entropy quantify exactly this shared information between the two parts. Okay? This is how I see the thing.
But is it the correlation? This information, is it the correlation? Quantum correlation?
It's also a quantum correlation, but okay, this could not be. This then depends really on the kind of variable you have for spins, what kind of correlation it is, etc., etc. But okay, it's not a classical correlation, that's for sure. Okay, you can call it quantum correlation. After it can be proved that this is goes out, I don't know exactly how to do it now by after the moment, but can be proved that any correlation between the two parts can be maximized by a function of the angle. This has been proved by some people. Okay, so if I take any other correlation of spin, of energy, or whatever between A and B, there is a quality that says this correlation would be smaller than the entanglement between the two, just because the entanglement in a way sum up all the quantum correlation between the two parts. All of that, not only sigma sigma or whatever.
So you are in a fixed inertial frame of calculation time. All this stuff.
Everything is fixed, no one is moving. It's a spin chain, spin fixed. It's a lattice where the spins are not allowed to move. Now, defining entanglement in relativistic theory, okay, in the sense, I will use quantum field theory in a second to quantify the entanglement of this kind of system, okay, but I'm not trying to give a relativistic invariant formulation of all this that is still quite an open problem, okay? Not to talk about the fact that in relativistic field theory, the number of particles is not fixed. You can have projection of particle and antiparticle. It's even a bit unclear what are the real degrees of freedom in a relativistic frame. That's why I didn't like much the word frame, because we end up in something that is unclear. Why? Okay, maybe someone said something about that, but honestly, what I'm saying is much lower level. Okay? And I don't want to make things too complicated. Okay, so this was the introductory part just to tell what are the quantities that we are going to study in a very general fashion. Now, I would like to make some connections on what we are interested really in. None of us is a quantum information scientist. And we usually don't deal with the random state that someone prepared us, but we want to know now the entanglement content that is in the states that nature provides us, okay? Like from quantum field theory or from condensed matter. And I would like to start with the entanglement that is contained in the ground state of a physical system, a Hamiltonian, okay? So, entanglement. In the ground state of a physical system. That means quantum field theory, spin chains, whatever, it's not really important. The real application. Okay? So, as usual, we imagine to have this wave function of the ground state. Let's use English from before, let's call ground state. Let's again derive the Hilbert space in two parts, HA times HB, in which A have access to part of the Hilbert space and both have access to other part of the Hilbert space that clearly does not move. And just to make a draw, let's make a spatial bipartition that means HA corresponds to really local variable of my quantum field theory or whatever. Let's imagine to draw, this is the full system lives in this sphere. We have a part A of the system and we have a part B of the system. What we want to do is to construct from the ground state the reduced density matrix rho A as trace over B of density matrix of the ground state. And from this construct the entanglement entropy as minus trace rho A not Roy.
Okay. The study of this problem started very long ago, actually. I want just to give some historical reference to give an idea of when it started. It was Bombelli from 88 and Schrödinger from 93. So it's more than 20, 25 years ago. And in this paper was put forward the idea that the entanglement entropy satisfies an area law. That means it's proportional to the area that divides the two parts of the system A and B. In this plot, the length of this curve is the area, okay? And nowadays, this result is proved. Quantum field theory here is massive. And there is a simple argument to explain it, but that clearly does not prove, but at least gives you an idea why this is the case. And this is connected to the fact that if the theory is massive, clearly there is a correlation length that measured to the decay of a correlation, m proportional to c to the minus 1. Okay. And this correlation length is finite. So we can imagine if these two parts are both very large, to draw a disk of width psi around the part A of the system. Okay. And all the entanglement between the part A and part B of the system will just come from this disk. Okay, of width psi. But the volume of the disk is not in fact psi times the area. So the entanglement entropy should be proportional to psi to this volume of the disk, because there is no entanglement coming from here to here if these two guys are not correlated. Okay? And so the entanglement entropy should follow an area law. Okay? And this, as you can imagine, was done mainly for connection with black hole entropy, which I would not like to enter now.
But sir, what means in case of condensed physics if we just have spins? What means massive UT in sense of condensed?
And the theory is a gap. Your condensed matter system has a finite gap. It's not massless. It's not gap. Okay, for people that know both fields, mass equal to gap.
Excuse me.
Yes.
In quantum mechanics, the entanglement of a quantum system depends on the set of observables that you choose. So how does it appear here? Is in quantum field theory, so you have to define also the set of observables to...
Well, in many details, but clearly what I'm telling is that I'm making a special bipartition between HA and HB. I choose an arbitrary basis in A and B. Okay? So this is completely fine, but then don't start mixing game with B. When you think depends on the choice of observable, what you are saying is, okay, I go to a basis that it's part here and part here that you can always do in a little space, but this is not part of the game. I'm saying there is an observer can see inside here and can make all the local operations that wants between the spins. They can rotate with the unitary operation between the spin that is here and the one that is here, but cannot make a unit operation between here and here. That clearly will change the entanglement between the two parts. Okay? This is exactly the operator dependence you have in mind. Okay? But when
I say I divide the system in space, and this is also what makes difficult to think in terms of frame. What does it mean space if I make a boost? Nothing. Okay, I change the space if I make a boost, but it's not what I. Okay, so I divide the space, then inside part A and part B, I'm free to choose any basis I want. Okay, and in the case of a quantum field theory, of a condensed matter system, whatever, there is a sense of locality, so it makes sense to say just the degrees of freedom localized in some part of the system, and so it's not something arbitrary. Okay, and then the entanglement will be just something quite universal.
So the entanglement will not depend on this choice of...
Absolutely not. As is clear from the definition. Changing basis inside A means just to change row A, but you leave its eigenvalues the same. And the entanglement depends only on the eigenvalue of this.
But in quantum mechanics, I'm not talking about a choice of basis, but a choice of observables itself. Because in quantum mechanics, this with different choices of observables, you can destroy entanglement. No? For example, you can take the hydrogen atom, have position and velocity for the two degrees of freedom.
Mm-hmm.
And you can choose two different bases, or you treat position and
velocity. Okay, I have to get your point. Momentum is non-local, observable in terms of position.
Yes.
It's Fourier transform, you sum over everything, okay? That's exactly what I'm saying. You don't have to make operations that sum up the two parts. Okay? If you think, I'm telling you that this area is satisfied, okay? This means it's like for every massive quantum field theory, particularly for a free field theory. A free field theory satisfies the area law, as we will see the proof even in the following, but then you can put, if I write in momentum space, the various modes are completely, they are independent. So in momentum space, there will be no entanglement, but this is not what we are doing. We are choosing a spatial repartition of the system. So there is sense of locality, okay, where X is, no time, just plot. Here, it's space, not space-time, okay? So it's time t equal to zero, system is in ground state, does not move from there, okay? This is what we are talking about. And the entanglement entropy scales like the area, the spatial area. That means if you take in terms of space-time, it's t minus two, not, okay? That's what we have in mind. Okay? So, and in the rest of this lecture, we will mainly concentrate on 1 plus 1 dimensional system, where we know a lot. Okay, so let me anticipate what do we know for 1 plus 1 dimensional system. It means one space and one time dimension. What I'm imagining, I have a one-dimensional system, I take A here and B here. If you want here, there is the time that for the moment place no matter. Okay? And what we know are the few following results that is my interest to show in the following. First, for a conformal field theory, that means a special class of 1 plus 1 dimensional critical system, which have also Lorentz invariance, that in Euclidean space means rotational invariance. The entanglement entropy is equal to C over 3 log L, where L is the distance between these two points, and in fact, this is a breaking of variable. As it should, because the theory is massless. And this number here in front is the central charge of the conformal field theory, and probably you have seen in other lecture here, I will not enter into this. And second, in a gap of massive, choose the word that you prefer, SA saturates to a constant, that is the one-dimensional version of the area law, because the area between the two points here is just two. Okay, the area between A and B is just the number of boundary points between the two parts, but still none. Okay, and we will try to see how this works. Just to give some historical thing, this formula was first derived by Olsen, Larsen, and Wilczek in 94. While this has been sort of argued and then proved later by Vidal et al. In 2003. And okay, I think we should make a break now and restart soon after. If you don't. So, welcome back, and let's now start with the real core of the course, that is entangling quantum field theory. Everything that I will be say, except I say differently, can be found in the review article with John Cardi in JPC 504005 of 2009. Okay. There will be something that is not written there, but I will tell explicitly when this is the case. Okay, so that to give reference to everyone to read in more details the things. And okay, to start with, and to have a very well defined problem, let us consider a lattice quantum field theory, okay, just to have a regularized problem with no divergence, etc., etc. So, just to make plot, here I will plot things in one dimension, but most of the things that I will say in this hour are applied in arbitrary dimension, okay, just that it's difficult to plot a space-time in more than one dimension. So this is our system, living on a lattice, but it's facing A. Euclidean time goes in this direction. Okay. And we want to be completely arbitrary. Let's imagine that in this system there is a given set psi of x local commuting observable. That is all what we need. Local and commuting are very important properties. And this object has, so when there is the at is an operator, they have a hidden values. Psi of x, say a phi of x, same symbol just without the at, and eigenvectors product over x of phi of x. Okay? This is just, if you want to continue having in mind spin chain is okay, just whatever you have, you can always find these things that define the quantum field theory you are dealing with. Okay. And the dynamics of the system is governed by an Hamiltonian, which we assume to be local, H, to which corresponds some Euclidean Lagrangian and some Euclidean action, whatever they are. The Euclidean action the integral between 0 and imaginary time, between 0 and beta, in the imaginary time of the Euclidean Lagrange. Okay? So, now we are at finite temperature just for concreteness, we will take the limit beta goes to infinity
after. Okay. So, first of all, we should construct the density methods. We want to arrive to the advantage. So, we construct the same step as before, density metrics, reduced density metrics, entanglement anchor. So, the density matrix, actually, its elements between two states, rho. So, these are eigenvectors, so I need the density matrix between two states, psi of x, rho of x prime, phi prime of x prime. This object now are the analogous of the index I that I had before. Okay, I hope you can read here. Okay, let's, now that I write in bracket, it will be clearer, I guess. This is nothing but the expectation value of phi of x, x e to the minus beta h, product over x prime, phi prime x prime, divided by the partition function at temperature beta, to ensure the normalization that the trace of rho is equal to 1. Okay? Now, what is this object in path integral? Density matrix depending on all this argument that is written here as the expectation value on a path integral on a slab of weak beta inverse temperature.
So, sorry, this is like the component, so to speak, of the
yes.
matrix, but in a continuous.
That's why I start from a lattice to not. Then we will assume everything to be continuous and it's fine. But just imagine to be well defined and not having problem in mind, just think it's a lattice. But as you will see, there is no big deal in thinking directly from with a continuous theory. Just okay, a bit of imagination to know what is a continuous cases. But okay. So we have a width, a strip in one dimension, in multi-dimension it's just a parallel pipe, a big, how it's called in English, the like a condensator. Okay. So the width of this strip is beta. We have boundary condition on the down side, so a time equal to zero. This is imaginary time tau equal to zero. This is imaginary time tau equal to beta. Here we have phi of x, and up here we have phi prime of x prime. Okay. If you want a formula for this plot, it is nothing but the integral, the path integral in the field phi of the e to the minus sc, Euclidean action, with the boundary condition. Then down, we have phi of x, comma 0, as time equals to 0. Should be equal. Now the indices are multiplying. Let's call this phi 1 and be easier. So the fields here should be equal to this boundary condition phi 1 of x. Why? The field on the upper edge should be equal to this phi t of x. Okay? I hope you are familiar with this notation. Okay, so I'm saying that we are making a path integral on a strip, and I impose a boundary condition that on the lower edge we have phi 1, and on the upper edge we have phi 2. And this is the density matrix between two states phi 1 and phi 2. If you want to think in terms of the spin before, imagine that this object is just telling me. Phi 1 corresponds to a set of plus minus, plus minus, plus minus. And the same for phi 2, if it's easier to think in these terms. Now, let us see, first of all, what is the effect of the trace in this notation? The trace, when I have matrix, means to take down an element and sum over there. That means I take the index I and the index j, I take the same, and then I have to sum also over there. In this case, the indices are represented by this field here, on which I have to sum. So what I have to do is to identify phi 1 of x with phi 2 of the same x, okay? Identify the two, and then sum over there. That means making the path integral over there. What is the net effect of this? Is to take this strip, identify means close to Fulma cylinder of circumference beta, and then sum over there. So, trace of rho is nothing that making this object. By the way, there is the partition function down there to divide, and this we have done in order to make one. And this just corresponds to the very standard facts that we should have seen already, that the partition function at final temperature in a quantum field theory is nothing but the real path integral on a cylinder of circumference beta. Yeah. Often it's just said or it's shown for free boson, free fermion that this works, and it remains always a bit mysterious why this is the case, but it's extremely easy to understand why within this construction. And in our case, it's also useful because we need to understand the role of the trace in order to construct the reduced density matrix. Because now what we want to do is to make this operation of trace not everywhere, but only in some part of the system. Okay? Let's imagine that part A of the system is an interval between Q point U and V. Okay? So what I want to do is to take the trace over B, that means the reduced density matrix rho A, is that I close this object to form a cylinder everywhere, but on the part A, that is here, between U and V, Q points, I hope you can all see. On the upper edge, I still have this phi 1 of x, and on the lower edge, I still have phi 2 of x. And this phi 1 and phi 2 corresponds exactly to those indices before on which I was not summing over. Okay? So the representation of the reduced density matrix in path integral is a cylinder with an open cut on path A. Okay, obviously all these divided by zeta or beta to ensure the normalization.
This is the trace of rho A.
So this is rho A. That means trace over B of the full rho.
Ah, okay.
So I'm tracing, that means I close a cylinder only on the part B of the system. Imagine this is our A. I'm closing this strip to make a cylinder, but only on the part B. On the part A, I leave the boundary condition I had before. And this is the main object we have to deal with. But now, some problems start, because I would like to calculate trace of rho A log rho A with this construction.
And this is not at all an easy object. When you have a matrix, if you want the logarithm of the matrix, how you get it? You have to diagonalize the matrix and make the logarithm of the values and then go back to the original basis. It's an basically impossible job to do in a general quantum theory. So we are not able to take the logarithm of this matrix. We have to circumvent this problem in some way. And the way we circumvent this problem is the following. Let us consider trace of rho a to the n to some power. If you have a matrix, let's imagine what's a matrix. If I have to make the power of the matrix, I don't have to diagonalize the matrix before. I just make the row by column of the multiplication. Okay? So this is an operation that does not require an a priori diagonalization. Okay? So let us consider this object. And in a second, I will say why it's easier in our framework, but let's see first of all where we end up with. From trace of rho a to the n with n integer, because if n is not integer, we are in the same problem of before. To find the power of the square root of a matrix, I have to make, I have always to analyze a priori. But if we know this object, okay, and we are able to calculate it for any integer n, then, and we will see an example in the following, what that means. If we are able to do this, we could be able to analytically continue to arbitrary real n, like you make for factorial that you said it's the gamma function. I just do have in mind what I'm telling you this word. And then if we are able to do this, the entanglement entropy that I'm interested in, that is minus trace of rho a log rho a, is just minus derivative with respect to n of trace of rho a to the n, calculated for n equal to 1. And this is the replica trick. This formula is obvious just because it's valid in each eigenvalues. So, okay? You can imagine if I'm able to diagonalize, this formula is valid for each of them just because the limit in the function for x equals 1 of d in the x of x to the n is equal to x log x. Okay, then I sum up over the eigenvalues. This is minus around, no, it's okay. Yes, people are always confused.
I just want to go back to the picture on the left hand board. So you've taken out this principle, this little region A.
Yeah.
This is taken out at fixed time.
Yes, this is at fixed time, how imaginary time, how we go to zero. There is no frame, there is. Don't think of space and time being the same thing. It's not in the framework we are working in. So
this cut is literally a one-dimensional line through.
Yes, this is a one-dimensional quantum field. One plus, there is time that makes the theory, the quantum theory one plus one-dimensional, and that's why I will always say one plus one-dimensional and not two-dimensional quantum field theory. That will be the nomenclature more used in this room, probably. Okay, but let's to be clear, this is one-dimensional quantum system. A spin chain,
I didn't mean that by dimension. I meant in terms of this line, this cut that you're making in the cylinder.
Yeah, the cut is, yeah, but if it's one dimensional and you are in the ground state, okay, or in the mixed state, that's by temperature, etc. But if you are in the ground state,
the ground state is a one-dimensional object.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm working with wave function, which is not at all about the environment, etc. So we are considering a cut at fixed time in the ground. Okay. Because we would, but not because we are arbitrarily decide to make a cut at fixed time, because we are working in the ground state of a one-dimensional system. And if you imagine to work in, just to have an idea why this is the case, if you imagine to work in Euclidean time, as we are doing, you can imagine to prepare the system at minus infinity in an arbitrary time, in an arbitrary state, then you evolve up to time tau equal to zero with the e to the minus h, and you end up in the ground state of the theory, because the evolution is imaginary time evolution, not real time evolution. Okay, so from wherever you start, the path integral will lead you to the ground state of the theory, and it's that ground state that you cast. Clearly, if I stop instead of tau equal tau equal any other arbitrary finite value is exactly the same, but in fact this is a cylinder, does not matter. Where is this cut? The only thing that matters is that it's parallel to the cylinder and not perpendicular. That will be another problem. Okay, thank you for the question. So I hope this left part of the blackboard is clear. Let's go to the right part. Do you have some questions on this right part? Okay? The idea on the right part here is, I want to get this object. To get this object, the only way that I know, in principle, is to diagonalize the matrix. But I'm not able to diagonalize the matrix, exactly what I'm doing. I'm trying to get something out of a matrix that I'm not able to diagonalize. There are questions?
No, leave it there. Is the limit correspond to
one? Ah, okay, yeah. Then. That's what I was going to say in a second, so I will solve automatic IDT. That's clearly complex.
Derivative with respect to M.
It's the one written here. I just wrote quickly because it was the same. Okay, so we are unable to make this logarithm. So for time being, let's do this trace of rho to the N. We will see why this is easier than this in a second. Then we make this, we hope to make this step that we will see in some cases it's just trivial, in some other cases it's difficult, and in some cases impossible. Okay, so it's not an easy step, it's one. That's what we are able to do. When we are able to do this, then the calculating time entropy is just a derivative. Like I said, it's an easy step in any case. Now, notice that n goes to 1 in this case. Maybe some of you have seen the replica trick, and then what's going to 0. This is what happened to the solar system. But in that case, people are interested just in the log of rho a. And that's why n goes to 0. We have a rho a log rho a, and then n should go to 1 and not 0. Okay. We can move on and trying to understand why trace of rho a to the n is much easier than calculating trace of rho a, than calculating the logarithm. Let me draw this rho a. I draw now in the other way just to have space on the blackboard. Okay, so time is always moving in this direction and space in this one. Okay, and this is the interval a. And let's imagine I want to calculate trace of rho a cubed, just to be flat. Okay, so I have three of these matrix rho a. Which are all identical with a cut here. And I have a phi 1 here, phi 2 here, let's say phi 3, phi 4, phi 5, phi 6. What does it mean that I have to make the product of these three matrices in this continuum plot? Usually, when I have two matrices,
A, I, J. And I want to make the square of this matrix. What I should do is A, I, J, A, J, K. That means identify these two indices and sum over them. But the indices here, row and column, correspond exactly to what is on the upper and on the lower edge of this cut. Okay? So identify J with K just means that I should identify what I call phi q here and what I call phi 3 here. That means I should identify this object with this object. That means the variables that are here are the same that are here, and then I sum over them as I'm summing in the path integral here. Normally, okay? I'm summing over all the values. So I make these two guys equal and sum. The same between phi 3 and phi 5 here. And this is the product of the three matrix that will depend on two indices, phi 1 and phi 6, that makes the I and J. But now I want to take also the trace of this guy, okay? And to take the trace means to identify these two object like this in a cyclic fashion and sum also over them.
You can do it the other way around as well, right? Identify, fight.
Yeah, sure, it's invariant. It's exactly because then I'm summing over this guy, so however I identify they go well. Okay? So, what is simpler in this plot? Then now I don't have any more indices or cuts. This is just a closed surface, a bit complicated, but still it's a closed surface, in which I'm summing over everything. Okay, so this is a partition function. And we are able to calculate partition function, as I will show in a second, but yeah, second, maybe in the afternoon. It's a partition function, but not as a temporal or something, or nothing in there, one is the object, on something a bit more complicated. Let's have a look to what is this guy in another plot, that would be helpful. And for doing this, let us consider the limit of beta that goes to infinity. That means in the Gram state, that's the only thing we are interested in the end of the day. Each of these cylinders will become just a plane. Let's have three of them. Now, the three plane are the three cylinder, and what I have said is that I have identified the lower edge, the back edge of here with the front here, okay? I have identified the back of this with the front of this, and the back of this one with the front of the first. I don't know if you are recognizing this plot, but surely you have seen this. This is just a actually, this plot is a three-sheeted Riemann surface. In general, will be n-sheeted for Bessel probably to the n. Why? Because if I move in the space-time now here, okay, if I move in the path B, I just in the imaginary time, let's imagine. So I move in the imaginary time at fixed x. If I move in the path B, I just remain on this sheet and nothing happens. When I move in imaginary time here, at an x that belongs to A, when I arrive to the cut, I don't go here. I go here. Then I continue going around. Then when I arrive here, again, I don't go here, but I go on the next sheet of the Riemann surface here. Then I continue moving around. I arrive here, and I wake up just on this side. Okay? I don't know if I make something in the other way around, but it's not that the problem. The point is, this is just an appreciated Riemann surface. That's exactly the object you have defined when you have made complex analysis to define the square, the root, the power 1/3 in complex analysis. It's nothing but that. Okay? And so what we are interested in is just to calculate the partition function, not on a plane, on a cylinder, on something very easy, but on something that is slightly more complicated, but it's still a partition function. So if you know, we don't need the correlation function that, as you well know, a very big object to calculate the entanglement and entropy. We just need partition function on strange objects. Yes, I admit this, but easy enough. And noting the note, please, that this construction is true in Arbeta dimension. Okay? Obviously, the object constructed by joining together these surfaces will be not called Riemann surfaces. It has not a name as far as I know, but whatever it is, I have just to join things in the part of the system that have the most strange shape, but I should just join cyclically in this way, and this construction is valid in arbitrary dimensions. So it has nothing to do with the 1D. I'm doing it in 1D mainly because I can draw things. And okay, it's already complicated to draw things in 1D. Now I have to be completely unable to make anything. And so, trace of going to the end as the object we are interested in is nothing but the partition function of this n-sheeted Riemann surface that will depend on the interval A. Obviously, in the time here, the normalization has been lost. There was the partition function at time tempered with beta that was everywhere. It's still there. And it's at power n because there was one for each density matrix. And so they are n in total. And we could call actually this object Z1. That means the partition function of the one sheeted Riemann surface that meets on the complex plane. Okay, so what we have to calculate is just the ratio of two partition functions. Before continuing, I want to give you an intuition why this will work. And to think this object in one plus one dimensional conformal field theory. And what you know in a one plus one dimensional conformal field theory is the logarithm of the partition function on this two-dimensional object. It always have a volume term, F1L squared. So this is a volume in the space-time now. If you want, divide by A squared, the Lattice cutoff that I put before, because the function is not finite, there will be a surface term, F2L divided by A, and then there are finite things in the ultraviolet limit. And in particular, among the finite things, there is this chi c log L, where chi c is the Euler characteristic of the surface. But we will see after. This is the famous Carpi pressure formula for people that know it. Okay, but it's just a. But the important point is not this guy here. The important points are these two objects here. This object, being volume and surface, do not really depend on the fact of having this interval. So in this ratio, they will always cancel. Okay, so all the ultraviolet things that we don't want, we just go away in this ratio, and we will be left with this. Okay, this is an anticipation just for people that can understand what this formula means, but in general, you can imagine partition function free energy are not UV finite, this you all aware. Then you can wonder how this object can be nice in the end. The reason is that in this ratio, ultraviolet divergence, at least the volume and the surface one cancel. There will be some remaining term in block, but we will see even this. and this object will be well defined. Okay, is this clear? I mean, not this last sentence, the rest. The last sentence can be clear only to people that know what we're talking about. So, as I said, everything that I wrote until now is true in another dimension, but there is something special with one dimension that I want to discuss now, that's the existence of twist fields. Okay, so all I'm saying is why in arbitrary dimension, in an arbitrary quantum field theory, in an arbitrary things that is even not a quantum field theory, okay, but it's just enough that there is locality. This is the only thing we use in this construction. Now, I want to specialize for one-dimensional quantum field theory, not at all conformal yet. Conformal will be much easier, and we even don't need this twist field to start with, but they are a useful concept even there. And in one dimension, so we have, let me draw everything like this. So we have this 1 plus 1 dimensional system where we have these two points, U and V. Here we have the cut. And with this plot, I just imagine all this structure here. That means when I go around here, continuously, I don't get up here, but I get in the other sheet of Riemann surface and so on and so forth. Okay? That's probably you've done okay with complex analysis. So it should be okay. And in this drawing, the partition function, this strange surface, let me call that Rn, is just the packed integral of a field or a set of fields that just like that moves on this surface. So this should be summed up everywhere. E to the minus the integral on these strange surfaces of dx d tau of some Euclidean Lagrangian density, that depends on x and tau, where x and tau all go in this strange Riemann surface. But from this plot, as you see, I just put something in U and V. I will be able to define some objects, some fields, that I just put in U and V and will make my game. This I cannot do in higher dimension, you can see already why, because okay, it should be an extended object like a string or whatever. But if I just see this definition, what come out does not seem so much local. To make it local, there is a good trick that comes from string theory, so you should know before than me. It's moving the complication from the worldship Rn to the target space, that is the field where the field lives. Okay, so here in this formula, Rn is the worldship that I can write complicated, while phi, a set of fields, is the target space that I can say it's simple in this plot. And now what I would like to do is to move the complication from here to here. It's time. Okay, give me just 3 minutes. What I want to move is this complicated from the up line to the bottom line.
Sorry, but you have R and also on the right. Where is N on the right?
Ah, yeah, this is R.
And also on the measure. The measure.
The measure?
You have Rn.
Yeah, these are all.
Okay.
It's just that I was not using N in my notes. Okay, then I introduced to show that it was N. But it's the strange Riemann surface. So, what I was telling is, I want to move this word from here to here. To this goal, instead of having one field phi, let's imagine to have any field phi, phi A, with A that goes from 1 to n. And now, this phi A depends only on x and tau, where now x and tau are on the complex plane and not in the engineered Riemann surface. But I want to write still this object here, not the partition function of an independent field that end up with something trivial. To this goal, then, I impose that the field I, when it arrives to 0 plus, times 0 plus, in the path A of the system, is equal to phi, where are the models? Phi I plus 1 in x 0 minus, when x belongs to A. While phi I of x 0 plus is only equal to x 0 minus if x belongs to B. So every time I'm on the path A of the system, the fields passing while in the other picture was the worksheet that was changing shape, now it's the name of the fields that change from 1 to 1 plus 1, from I to I plus 1. With the obvious identification that 1 is equal to n plus 1 to have the cyclic permutation of these replicas. Okay? And so, my partition function, Z of n, I'm interested in, this is the object we want to calculate. This will be equal to the path integral over all these fields f by 1, f by n. Okay, on this contour that will depend on u and v, with this constraint, so not contour, on this constraint at this one, this is what I call constraint depending on u and v. So the fields are not free anymore, but they are constrained. It's like an orbital, but an idea for people that know what it is. And now, e to the minus integral over the complex plane, because x and tau just go from the complex plane, dx d tau, Lagrangian of the field phi 1, plus Lagrangian of the field phi q, etc., etc., Lagrangian of the field phi n. Okay, and these constraints are such that satisfy those conditions. Okay, and clearly the sum of these Lagrangians I can always define as the total Lagrangian is sum lambda by I that goes from 1 to n. And this relation, that as it is written, being a local relation for the field phi I, given by this constraint here, automatically defines some twist field. Yeah, there is some problem? Some typo?
I'm wondering, so x and t are each complex, not together?
No.
Oh, they're not each complex.
Okay,
yeah, because I thought...
Sorry. Z is equal to x plus I tau.
Yeah.
Completely standard notation
yeah.
That I And that's the guy that thought. That's why the impact, it's a single impact on the complex plane, it's just that barbecue.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for the question. So, this object here that I wrote just depends on this U and V in a local way, so I can define this as being proportional to correlation function of some twist field, tau n u0, tau n tilde, another field in V0. Okay? Just because in this definition, by translational invariant, this object can depend only on these two. On these two points, U and V, and on nothing else. So I define this to be proportional. Okay, there is a multiplication constant that should be fixed by the normalization that we decide as we want. And actually, this normalization is fixed by this condition, and then I leave you to have lunch. The normalization constant in general is picked for the expectation value of a general local operator or a collection of local operators, call as you want, with the Lagrangian L in the n-sheeted Riemann surface to be equal to the expectation value of the same collection of operators, okay, times tau n in U, tau n theta in V, on the complex plane the total Lagrangian spins divided by tau n u tau theta n v on the complex plane with ln, and this fixes every arbitrary in proportionality constant. Clearly, the partition function corresponds to the operator here being nothing, one, the identity, and in this case we have the expectation value normalized, give just one as it should. Okay, so each operator can be written in this way. Each expectation value of operator on its n-sheeted Riemann surface can be seen as expectation value on a single complex plane with insertion of some twist field. This is not a very fundamental thing, but we left in some cases, so I like to let you know, especially because, okay, in the string theory, you introduce these things all the time, so should not be new to you. Actually, as far as I understand, in string theory, you can define a twist field every time that there is a global symmetry. And in this case, the symmetry that we have is the symmetry for exchange of replicas. Okay, the cyclic permutation of a replica, if I start counting by one or I start counting by three, it's exactly the same thing. Okay, so you have this global symmetry, and this global symmetry defines these two operators. This is going up of one, this is going down of one, corresponding to the global symmetry. Okay, so this is just a thing that I say for the people that know the correspondence in string theory and maybe can help understanding what I'm talking about. If you don't know, it's not me. Okay, thank you, and see you later.